Hey, Dr. Bernard here. This case was an accident that's becoming more prevalent in the United States. I'm going to describe to you what a case of it looks like medically, but know that the presentation can look different based on the patient's age. So a massive ingestion will affect a toddler different than it will an adolescent, different than it will an adult. In the United States, your local poison center can be reached by phone at 1-800-222-1222 anytime you might think one of these accidents has happened. A clinically trained toxicology specialist will be there on the phone to help. I'll also tell you why the toxicity of this massive ingestion happens the way that it does, as well as some steps that you can take to help prevent something like this from happening should you be in the presence of children. A girl mistakenly ate 96 gummy edibles for lunch. This is what happened to her brain. NP is a 12-year-old girl presenting to the emergency room with a possible head injury. Her mother, Rebecca, tells the admitting nurse that she found NP struggling on the floor. When Rebecca tried talking to her daughter, none of the words that came out made any sense. NP was born into a happy family, but her dad, Tony, would sometimes get in trouble with her mom because of one particular kind of food that he loved to eat. Tony had an herbal habit. When he was younger, those herbs would somehow just find their way into his lungs. He would totally have no idea how they got in there. But as a connoisseur of sound, natural plants that come directly from the earth, Tony strongly believed in an oil extract that his friend would prepare from this plant and put into brownies, cookies, and gummy candies. This oil contained all of the cannabinoid compounds that exert the desired effect from consuming the herb in its various forms. Just having some delicious treats, he thought. One day, Tony accidentally ate too many gummy edibles. As he lost track of where he was, he walked out of the house to go buy some milk, and then he fell down the stairs. Rebecca, unhappy with her husband living like this, confiscated all of his edibles. But Tony was undeterred. One day, he purchased a mega stash. In the kitchen cabinet was a bag of regular candy. He thought of a good way to hide this from his wife, so he mixed this mega stash of edibles into this bag of candy, simply disguised so that no one would know as he placed the bag back into the cabinet. The next day, NP decided to look for some snacks while watching some YouTube videos. In the cabinet was a really large bag of delicious-looking candy as she grabbed it to go and sat down on the couch. On the first taste, NP thought that the gummy candies were delicious, such a soft and pleasing texture while chewing, with just the right kind of cherry flavor, completely oblivious to the fact that there was a dose of psychoactive cannabinoids in each one. She had no idea that if she ate more than one or two, something would start to happen. She kept grabbing more and more from the bag as she kept eating while watching her videos. As the hour passed, NP started feeling different. At first, she didn't know exactly what was happening. She could feel the sides of her eyes start to get dark. Her heart started beating faster and more pronounced. She noticed that her breathing was different than normal, but she didn't know why. The images on her tablet screen started to look funny to her as she laid her head back, but then her stomach started to squirm. At first, she didn't realize that she had eaten nearly the entire bag of candy. But as she looked, the contents were mostly consumed and absorbing into her body. And as her stomach felt more and more unstable, she stumbled into the bathroom ready to heave, not because she wanted to, but because she felt that something was going to come up, but it never did. On the way outside to get some fresh air, NP stumbled out of the door. Unaware of where she really was, she fell down the stairs. Hearing this chaos and completely unaware of what had happened, Rebecca rushed out to find her daughter on the floor. Asking NP if she was okay, Rebecca couldn't get a coherent response. In a panic, Rebecca, thinking that her daughter had just sustained a head injury falling down, she calls for 911, and NP's brought to the emergency room where we are now. At examination, doctors noted that NP was somnolent. When they could get a response from her, the words weren't coherent. She couldn't tell them where she was, and she couldn't tell them her name. Because she fell down the stairs, they were concerned that maybe she had sustained a head injury, but a scan showed that everything was normal. A blood test also found nothing abnormal in NP. If she consumed a majority of her dad's mega stash of gummy edibles, and those edibles created an obtunded mental state for NP, how would the medical team be able to discern the difference between head injury falling down the stairs and strung out from an accidental massive ingestion of edibles? The cannabis plant has an abundance of chemicals in it that are known to have a physiologic effect on the body. The ones that are psychoactive are cannabinoids, the most well-known being delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, also known as THC. This shouldn't be confused with CBD, which is cannabidiol, which also comes from the cannabis plant and has been shown to help with seizure disorder in children whose seizures don't respond well to multiple medicines. CBD doesn't appear to be psychoactive. This brings us to the idea of absorption. Many times when people think of cannabis, they think of inhalation. Normally when we breathe, the oxygen from the air inhaled is exchanged for carbon dioxide exhaled. That inhaled oxygen sticks to the red blood cells and is then circulated throughout the body. When oxygenated blood exits the heart, a large percentage of it goes from the aortic arch into the carotid artery and into the brain. But if someone is inhaling smoke from an herb instead of oxygen from the air, then the exchanged gas from the smoke gets into the blood, pumped out of the heart, into the aortic arch, into the carotid artery, and directly into the brain. This is how delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol can exert its psychoactive effect when inhaled, because it gets to the brain quickly through this route of administration. But NP didn't inhale. She ate the edibles instead, meaning that there's a difference in absorption. Anything eaten by mouth goes into the stomach, makes its way into the small intestines, and then is absorbed into the liver where it's processed, it's metabolized, and broken down. So, when something is eaten, it doesn't go to the brain first. The interesting thing about delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol is that in the liver, it's broken down to 11-hydroxy-tetrahydrocannabinol. One goal of liver metabolism is to make chemicals more hydrophilic. Hydro meaning water and philic meaning affinity for. Making a chemical have more water affinity means that you're making it more water soluble, so it can dissolve in water and concentrate in the urine so it can be eliminated from the body, hence why the liver is called the detox organ. Water is made of hydrogen and oxygen, so when chemicals contain more hydrogens and oxygens, they should technically have more affinity for water. And when we look at the name 11-hydroxy tetrahydrocannabinol, this metabolite of delta-9 THC from gummy edibles makes sense. However, nature isn't straightforward because 11-hydroxy THC happens to be even more psychoactive than delta-9 THC, meaning as NP mistakenly ate her dad's secret stash of gummy edibles, her liver turned the megadose of THC into a megadose of an even more active version of THC. The state of Colorado did research and estimated that 11-hydroxy THC from an edible could be almost 6 times more potent than delta-9 THC that goes directly to the brain during inhalation. But it doesn't stop here. Inhaling the smoke is known to exert the full psychoactive effect within minutes. But when an edible is consumed by mouth, the process of passing through the gut into the liver, then through the bloodstream to the brain, can take an hour or more. And during that time, especially if the person has no idea that there's cannabinoids contained within, one can consume a dose 10 times or more compared to inhalation, delayed in onset, with the effect getting more and more intense as more gummies are eaten and absorbed into the blood, bringing us back to NP. In the emergency room, the results of a urine toxicology screen returns, and it tells the medical team that present in NP's urine are cannabinoids. This should make sense. The liver is there to make chemicals hydrophilic, and the kidneys have eliminated some cannabinoids into the urine, but for NP, she's still obtunded. We know that the liver's attempt to metabolize the cannabinoids created an even more potent psychoactive compound in the first pass, but why is she still like this? This brings us back to hydrophilicity. If a chemical mixes well with water, it won't mix well with oil and vice versa. So, if there exists an affinity for water, then the opposite case of affinity for oil exists, something called lipophilicity. Lipo from Greek, referring to fats or oils. NP's dad, Tony, had a friend who made the gummy edibles that he ate. These candies were infused with an oil that was the extract of all the cannabinoids from raw plant material and was infused into the gummies to make the edibles. Delta-9 THC is lipophilic. 11-hydroxy THC is still lipophilic, though slightly less than delta-9. The nerves in all the body are covered by a myelin sheath, which helps conduct signals faster, and these are made of fats. The brain and the cells within are also made of majority fats. All of this bringing us to the idea of distribution. As Delta 9 and 11-hydroxy-THC reaches the brain, it deposits in. Because of the lipophilicity, it preferentially stays in fat tissue, like the brain, as opposed to staying in the bloodstream. An amount of 11-hydroxy-THC will make it back to the liver again to be broken down yet another time to 11-nor-9-carboxy-THC. Which isn't psychoactive, but still lipophilic enough to be contained in the organs and slowly leach out into the bloodstream and make its way into the urine in detectable amounts for more than a week. So we know Delta-9 THC edibles become an even more potent version of THC in the liver. We know it preferentially distributes into fat tissue, notably the brain. But why does it produce the psychoactive effect? Well, Delta-9 and 11-hydroxy-THC both happen to fit into structures in the brain where the nerves connect. Naturally, our bodies produce endogenous cannabinoids, endo meaning from within and genus referring to production. Our body doesn't make THC, but it makes compounds that appear to be similar in function. Endogenous cannabinoids appear to be used to regulate other neurotransmitters that actively send signals throughout the nerves. When THC is present, it looks like the concentrations of neurotransmitters change. This is what produces the effect, and because such a huge dose of it is floating around in NP, it explains what's happening to her brain. This disruption in normal neurotransmitter levels in the brain could be responsible for cannabis hyperemesis syndrome, where herb consumers will empty their stomach multiple times because emesis can be mediated by some neurotransmitters. But there's a lot more to cannabinoid neuropharmacology than what we know about today. Some strains of plant will change neurotransmitter concentrations in different ways, and sources of the cannabinoids in edibles may be different, so categorizing for sure whether it's a stimulant or a depressant isn't accurate. An interesting point is that cannabinoid receptors don't appear to be in abundance on the brainstem. This is important because this is where the respiratory centers are that control our breathing, meaning for adolescents and adults who may accidentally ingest a massive dose of edibles, it typically won't lead to respiratory arrest. This appears to be a different situation for toddlers, who we now have some more data on in context of cannabis poisoning, as it appears some of them who do mistakenly take a massive ingestion of THC may need respiratory support, usually different than in the adolescent and adult case. Because of this, for young children, if you suspect accidental cannabis edible ingestion, don't wait. Seek help from your local poison center immediately. The United States Food and Drug Administration issued a notice that incidence of accidental pediatric edible ingestion has been increasing, with more calls being logged to poison control centers across the United States. Some of the reason could be the fact that the packaging of these edibles is designed to look like candy that you find at stores. If they're cookies or brownies, the packaging doesn't need to resemble anything because of the clear plastic containers that we often find these goods in. There's also a Delta-8 THC, of which products are becoming more common. It's generally accepted that its effects are roughly the same as Delta-9 THC, if it's not a little less potent, maybe causing a little different feel. And the metabolic pathway for it is similar, creating 11-hydroxy Delta-8 THC, which appears more potent than Delta-8 THC. A news story in late 2022 noted a death caused by this Delta-8 THC toxicity in Northern Virginia, confirmed by the chief medical examiner, with another case listed in the FDA notice predating the news story by at least a few months. Both of these deaths could possibly be associated with the patients not receiving early respiratory support during the toxicity, which is one way that the young child can present, although we would need more information about those particular cases. A good way to prevent this from happening should you be in the presence of children is to place edibles in a physical location not visible and not reachable by children. I'm not singling out cannabis versus other potentially dangerous things in the house. There can be many. As it is right now, this stuff happens to look like candy, cookies, brownies, and other fun treats which can confuse kids. And if you're a parent, you can weigh the risk of what you want to have in the house. If it's not realistic not having edibles in the house, placing them in a way where they can't see it and can't get to it, like in a high cabinet, closed door, can can help. If you leave the edibles in a hot car or in a bathroom where shower steam can get warm, those can compromise the stability of the compounds contained within, so those aren't recommended places. There's also medication lockboxes that can help limit access to who can get in. Typically, if there's even a little barrier to entry, it usually doesn't get consumed because the person can't be bothered. For NP, the hospital had a conversation with her parents when the urine toxicology screen returned for cannabinoids. Despite being an accident, Child Protective Services did have to be notified by the medical team because of federal law. But as it turned out, this was an accident. After some observation in the hospital, care from the medical team, and awareness for the parents, NP was able to make a full recovery. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.